this is Candy with Eyes to Jesus.blogspot.com. And join me as we continue our study going through the whole book of Isaiah. So today we're doing Isaiah chapter 49. If you are behind or just now joining me for the first time, you don't have to worry about watching the 48 previous videos. Feel free to jump in right here. No need to be overwhelmed. If you would like to follow along with me in the Bible translation that I am using, I will be reading from the Young's Literal Translation, also known as the YLT. So let's just get right into this and get started. So I'm going to pop on my granny spectacles and let's turn to Isaiah chapter 49, beginning with verse 1 that says, "Hearken, O isles, unto me, and attend, O peoples, from afar. For Jehovah from the womb hath called me. From the bowels of my mother he hath made mention of my name." Now, we'll get into in a minute who's speaking here, okay? But notice it says, hearken, that means listen, pay attention. And it says, O isles. And then it also says, O peoples from afar. So whoever this is speaking, they're saying this to the whole world, to all the nations, to the lands afar, to the islands afar, to the coastlands, every place. All right. And he continues speaking in verse 2 where he says, "And he maketh my mouth as a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he hath hid me. And he maketh me for a clear arrow. In his quiver he hath hid me. And he saith to me, My servant thou art, O Israel, in whom I beautify myself." So this is someone who came from a womb, as we see in verse 1, but is referred to as Israel. This is a descendant of Israel, and this is a very specific descendant of Israel. In fact, this is Revelation chapter 12 here, okay? So if we turn to the book of Revelation chapter 12, and let's take a look at verses 1 through 2, and that says, "And a great sign was seen in the heaven, a woman arrayed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And being with child, she doth cry out, travailing and pained to bring forth." So this is the child of this woman whose sign we see in the stars in Revelation chapter 12. And this woman has a crown of 12 stars around her head. Those are the 12 tribes of Israel. And the woman is Israel, personified as a woman. And who does she give birth to? Jesus Christ, who is the first fruits of the New Covenant Church. So that's what that's talking about here. And then this also parallels, of course, with Joseph's dream in the book of Genesis, where he dreams with the same figurative symbolism. So we have scripture interpreting scripture here to show us all these things. Okay, so this is Jesus speaking. Jesus is the Word of God, and Jesus is God. And Jesus becomes the Word of God made flesh when he is physically born, as we read about in the Gospels. All right, so this is Jesus speaking, okay? And then continuing in verse 4, he says, "And I said, for a vain thing I labored, for emptiness and vanity my power I consumed. But my judgment is with Jehovah and my wage with my God." Because Jesus died, and he died at age 33, and he died to pay for the sins of the world. So he didn't just pay for the sins of Christians. He paid for the sins of everybody. When it got dark for those 3 hours in the middle of the afternoon right before his death, because that was the light leaving the world. We'll get into that light a little bit in this chapter in a little bit. Leaving the world, because that was Jesus taking on the sins of every single human being, whoever existed, past, present, and future. Remember, linear time is a construct. We need it. God does not. So God paid for all of those sins in the form of Jesus Christ. He paid for it as if he did those sins and we did not. Those of us who go to heaven are those of us who simply acknowledge, accept, believe, and receive that free gift of Jesus dying to pay for our sins. But all these millions and millions and millions and millions of people that Jesus died to pay for the sins of, who refuse him, who don't want to turn to him, who will give some of the arguments that we'll come across in this chapter, that was empty, vain, didn't do anything right. He did it for them, and they eschewed the free gift. But that's also why it's a gift. When you give someone a gift, you're giving something of yourself freely, and that person is free to accept or reject that gift. So then we have this qualified with, but my judgment is with Jehovah and my wage with my God. And the scriptures talk about how it was God's will that God the Son would do this. See, God, who is outside of linear time, he already sees every possibility and he sees everything at once. And he saw the most people get saved if I become flesh as my son and I die to pay for their sins. And how many people lives at? The book of Daniel actually gives us percentages. It's 1% of all humanity that ever existed actually receives a free gift. 99% does not. God isn't doing it your way, so you're not going to go to heaven. You're going to choose your sins over the joy and blessings of God. We'll go right ahead. Everybody who ends up in hell will know that they deserve it and why they are there. Because all things will be made known and they will have to face the truth. And guess what? Everyone in hell, they are going to be, in my opinion, raging mad. It's going to be a place devoid of love, joy, and happiness. They're going to be angry and their anger is going to grow because they're mad that God didn't do it their way. Continuing on with verse 5, and now said Jehovah, who is forming me from the belly for a servant to him, to bring back Jacob unto him, so to bring the people of God to God, though Israel is not gathered, yet I am honored in the eyes of Jehovah, and my God hath been my strength. You know, we get that promise also in, I believe it's Philippians 4:13. In fact, let's just turn to Philippians 4:13, God being our strength here really quick. Most Bible translations actually have this wrong, and it creates this really weird contradiction type of thing, a really weird, illogical thing. But in the Young's Literal Translation, it is translated correctly. Okay, so Philippians 4:13 correctly says, for all things I have strength in Christ's strengthening me. Yet the King James Version and many other translations will say, I can do all things in Christ who strengthen me. Can you do all things? No. One, you're a finite being. You're under the linear construct of time. So you are limited by that. You're limited, therefore, by the laws of entropy. You're limited by the laws of physics. Can you alter your molecular structure and phase through objects? No. So can you do all things through Christ? Not currently, right? But for all things I have strength in Christ's strengthening me. Do you struggle with anxiety? Do you struggle with fears? You give these fears, these burdens, these anxieties to Jesus and let him strengthen you through his Holy Spirit. And that's what that's talking about. Okay, so now off of that rabbit trail and back to Isaiah chapter 49, verse 6, and he saith, it hath been a light thing that thou art to me. So this is God speaking to Jesus. And he saith, it hath been a light thing that thou art to me for a servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and the preserved of Israel to bring back. And I have given thee for a light of nations to be my salvation unto the end of the earth. So Jesus Messiah is not just to bring Israel back to God, but it is also to bring all the nations to God. And what does it say here? It says that he is a light to the nations. So Jesus is a light. And in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus teaches that us, the children of God, we are supposed to let our lights shine. If you are a saved, born-again Christian, your light is supposed to be shining. That means the world should know you're a Christian. Your friends should know. Your family should know. You should be living the Christian life. You should be gladly sharing the gospel. You let your light shine. Jesus says, if you are ashamed of him before men, then he is ashamed of you before his Father, which is in heaven. So, going off of light, let's turn to John chapter 8. And in John chapter 8, let's take a look at verse 12. And that says, again, therefore, Jesus spake to them, saying, I am the light of the world. He who is following me shall not walk in the darkness, but he shall have the light of the life. Are you in the light or are you in the darkness? You are a child of the light if you are a child of Jehovah God. And you're a child of Jehovah God if you have received that free gift of Jesus dying on the cross to pay for all of your sins. And you walk in the light. That means you are a Christian. Christian means Christ follower. That means you walk the straight and narrow path. You want to walk the Christian walk. And sure, you're going to stumble and fall here and there. We're in these sinful bodies in this sinful world. But when we do, we have the promise of 1 John 1:9. We confess those sins to who? To God. Not to any priests, not to any special spiritual person, to God. And then God forgives us. And where do we get our strength to carry on, to learn from our mistakes, and to move on? From Jesus, right? Philippians 4:13. All right, so resuming in Isaiah chapter 49, so let's go to verse 7. And that says, "Thus said Jehovah, Redeemer of Israel, His Holy One." So who's speaking here? Jehovah, Redeemer of Israel, His Holy One. So this is Jesus speaking, and He says, "To the despised in soul, to the abominated of a nation, to the servant of rulers, kings see and have risen, princes and worship for the sake of Jehovah, who is faithful, the Holy of Israel, and He chooseth thee. Thus said Jehovah, in a time of good pleasure, I answered thee." Okay, so Jesus died for everybody. Okay, but God is not in linear time, right? Okay, so we see, you know, some inklings of that in Ephesians chapter 1 and Romans chapter 8, right? Where God already knows who's going to get saved and who isn't. And so those who get saved, therefore, are chosen of God. And why are they chosen of God? Because they chose God. And so God already knows who's going to receive and who isn't going to. But we're in linear time, so we're still playing it out. But God's already at the beginning, middle, and the end. Okay, so then verse 8, God speaking, "Thus said Jehovah, in a time of good pleasure I answered thee, and in a day of salvation I helped thee, and I keep thee and give thee for a covenant of the people to establish the earth, to cause to inherit desolate inheritances." So the word testament is synonymous with the word covenant, right? And a covenant is, like you could say, a deal, an agreement between two or more parties. So we have the Old Testament, and that is the Old Covenant. Then we have the New Testament, and that is the New Covenant. So the Old Covenant was before Jesus became flesh and died to pay for our sins, where the people of God put their faith in the future coming Messiah. Now we're under the New Covenant, where the Messiah came, He died to pay for our sins, and now we put our faith in the Messiah who died to pay for our sins and who rose from the dead 3 days later. Verse 9, "To say to the bound, go out, to those in darkness, be uncovered, on the ways they feed, and in all the high places is their pasture." Are you in the dark? You are if you are not a child of God. And God calls us to go into the light, God's light, not the fake light of Satan. Because, you know, the New Testament says that even Satan can be transformed into an angel of light. And that's partially why God says also that my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Make sure you're seeking the correct light. Verse 10. "They do not hunger nor thirst, nor smite them, doth mirage and sun, for He is pitying them, doth lead them, and by the fountains of water doth tend them." And so what is this here? These are blessings. This is talking about how the children of God, they receive protections and blessings from God. Verse 11, "And I have made all my mountains for a way, and my highways are lifted up." So even if you have what seems to be insurmountable obstacles in your way, these mountains that look like you can't go over them or around them, these things in your way, these struggles in your life, you put your trust in God and you watch how He will bring you over those mountains. Verse 12, "Lo, those from afar come in, and lo, these from the north and from the sea, and these from the land of Sinim." So this is a two-part fulfillment. The first part fulfillment is regathering of Israel as a nation, which began taking place in 1948. Jews from all around the world started regathering at Israel and Jerusalem back to part of the Promised Land. Now, they still don't have all of the Promised Land back, but at least they got a little bit of it back, more than they had before then for quite a long time. And then the final fulfillment will be when all of the Promised Land is back, and when all of the children of God, spiritual Israel, regardless of genetic heritage and genetic lineage, gathers at New Jerusalem, where God himself will dwell with us, literally being heaven on earth. Verse 13, sing, O heavens, and joy, O earth, and break forth, O mountains, with singing, for comforted hath Jehovah his people, and his afflicted ones he doth pity. Do you need comfort? Do you need some promises of God? Read and study Philippians chapter 4. Verse 14, and Zion saith. So now we have someone else speaking. So this, now it's saying Zion instead of Israel here, because we already used Israel as personifying Jesus being the one who comes from the womb of Israel to save the world, those who will choose him. So now we have a differentiation. So now instead of saying Israel here, it's saying Zion. And this is referring to the people of God. So the people of God says, right? And Zion saith, Jehovah hath forsaken me, and my Lord hath forgotten me. Okay, so back in this time, historically, they're saying that because captivity, you know, is the house of Israel went into captivity to the Assyrians, and then the house of Judah goes into captivity to the Babylonians, and they had some really hard times. And why did God allow that captivity? Because they turned to the false gods. Now, when I say false gods, these are not imaginary fairy tale gods. I call them false gods because they are not the one true God. These gods are fallen angels and demons, and their demonic Nephilim, Raphaim offspring. So these false gods, for example, the Greek pantheon, they did exist. And some of them still do exist. And they will come back again, such as Apollyon that we read about in the book of Revelation. Okay, but when you are in a hard time and you're a child of God and you're having these trials, troubles, and tribulations and you feel like God has abandoned you, you need to stop and think, did God abandon you or did you abandon him? These people are saying, God left me, he forsook me. No, no, no. They left God. So they lost the blessings of God. Okay, so verse 15, so God responds and he says, forget doth a woman her suckling, the loved one, the son of her womb? Yea, these forget, but I forget not thee. So God's saying, does a woman forget her nursing baby? Of course not. And I love you even more than a mother loves her child. So clearly I have not forgotten you. Therefore, even though you're going through trials and tribulations right now, that doesn't mean that I have forgotten you. Doesn't mean that you're going to continue going through them. What it does mean is repent, reform, turn back to the Lord, and put your trust in him. Verse 16, lo, on the palms of my hand I have graven thee. Thy walls are before me continually. God loves us so much that we are engraved on the very palms of his hands. How does that work? Remember this is Jesus speaking. Jesus and Jehovah are the same. So let's turn to John chapter 20. And in John chapter 20, let's take a look at verses 24 through 28. And that says, and Thomas, oh, by the way, and this is taking place after Jesus' resurrection. Okay, verse 24. And Thomas, one of the 12, who is called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. And he saith to them, if I may not see in his hands the mark of the nails, and may put my finger in the mark of the nails, and may put my hand to his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again were his disciples within, and Thomas was with them. Jesus cometh, the doors having been shut, and he stood in the midst and said, peace to you. Then he said to Thomas, bring thy finger hither and see my hands, and bring thy hand and put it to my side, and become not believing, but believing. That is a fulfillment right there, where we see back here in Isaiah chapter 49, first part of verse 16, lo, on the palms of my hand I have graven thee. So you're saying, God doesn't love me. God has forsaken me. Hello, God died for you. You are permanently engraved on the palms of his hands. Take a look at the palms of Jesus' hands when you meet him, if you're a child of God. You are engraved there because he loves you that much. Verse 17, hastened, have those building thee, those destroying thee, laying thee waste, go out from thee. In other words, Psalm 37, wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord, His timing. What happens? They're under oppression now, but now their enemies are fleeing. Now they've turned back to God, and God has therefore turned back to them. Verse 18, lift up round about thine eyes and see. All of them have been gathered. They have come to thee. I live. An affirmation of Jehovah. Surely all of them as an ornament thou puttest on, and thou bindest them like a bride, because thy wastes and thy desolate places and the land of thy ruins surely now are straitened because of inhabitants. And far off have been those consuming thee. The enemies have been brought to naught. Verse 20, again do the sons of thy bereavement say in thine ears, the place is too strait for me. Come nigh to me and I dwell. And thou hast said in thy heart, who hath begotten for me these? And I, bereaved and gloomy, a captive and turned aside, and these who hath nourished, lo, I was left by myself. These, whence are they? When they are in the captivity, they thought, again, they're just saying again, well, God forsook me, I was left by myself. Did any of the actual true people of God have to suffer through this? No. The actual true people of God, many if not all of them, remember they were the remnant, as we studied earlier in Isaiah. There was a remnant of the house of Israel, and there was a remnant of the house of Judah, where they got to escape this captivity, and they got to stay back and work the land. So even if everyone around you is receiving the judgment of God, if you are a child of God, you're going to receive a measure of protection from God. You don't have to be a partaker of their judgments. And that's why Jesus and God is saying in the book of Revelation to come out of the whore of Babylon, to come out of Roman Catholicism, because you don't want to be receiving of her, which is apostate Christianity's judgments. Verse 22, thus said the Lord Jehovah, lo, I lift up unto nations. God isn't just for Israel. He's for the Israel of God, that spiritual Israel. He's for everyone who chooses to be a person of God, regardless of genetic lineage. All right. Lo, I lift up unto nations my hand, and unto peoples I raise up my ensign. And they have brought thy sons in the bosom, and thy daughters on the shoulders are carried. And kings have been thy nursing fathers, and their princes thy nursing mothers. Face to the earth they bow down to thee, and the dust of thy feet they lick up. And thou hast known that I am Jehovah, that those expecting me are not ashamed. So he's talking about the unsaved nations will even come eventually unto Jerusalem. And what is the final fulfillment of that? Well, that will be after the seven-year tribulation. Then we have the great white throne judgment. And then we have New Jerusalem, the city of God, that actually comes down onto the Jerusalem site on earth, heaven on earth. And then Revelation talks about, and the nations flow to it, but the children of God live in it. Verse 24, is prey taken from the mighty, and the captive of the righteous delivered? For thus said Jehovah, even the captive of the mighty is taken, and the prey of the terrible is delivered. And with thy striver I strive, and thy sons I save. With thy striver I strive. The Bible says in both Old and New Testaments, it says that vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. The Bible says don't return evil for evil. If someone does something evil to you, you don't take revenge and take evil back on them. What do you do? The New Testament says instead, you return kindness for evil. And that's like heaping hot coals over their head. Meanwhile, the vengeance, the revenge, the punishment, God handles that. Verse 26, and I have caused thine oppressors to eat their own flesh, and as new wine they drink their own blood. And known have all flesh that I, Jehovah, thy Savior and thy Redeemer, am the Mighty One of Jacob. So we have some hyperbole there, licking the dust off of the feet, eating their own flesh, drinking their own blood. But that hyperbole is to illustrate that those who oppress the children of God are going to receive the wrath of God. Because as a nursing mother is very protective over her baby, multiply that by a million times, and that's how protective the Heavenly Father is over us, His children. And isn't it beautiful, isn't it glorious that it's up to us if we are His child or not. See, Jesus died for the whole world. John 3:16 says that God loved the whole world, that he gave his son to die for us. God gave us free will. The Bible says that it is not God's will that any of us should go to hell. But God gave up some of his free will so that we can have free will. He will not force anyone to go to heaven. We all need to make that choice for ourselves. True scriptural Christianity is not a religion because we're not doing rituals. We're not having to face a certain day and pray five times a day and wash our feet and repeat prayers while we count beads on a strand, on a necklace. We're not having to do any of that stuff. That's man-made baloney. A lot of that's secret Babylon. It's just a choice. It's just a choice. Will you make the proper choice if you haven't yet already? God loves you. Jesus died on the cross for you to pay for your sins. Are you willing to give up what you think how it should be done? And are you willing to trust God and that he knows better than you and that he is smarter than you? Will you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And if that answer is yes, that's all you got to do is pray to God and tell him that you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and that you believe that Jesus died on the cross to pay for all of your sins and that you want Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Savior, you understand that. He died to pay for your sins. Lord means master. A Christian is a Christ follower. Become a disciple of Christ and have a blessed day.